Welcome to another episode of Surgeons' Lives. I'm your host, John Monson. My guest today is Dr. Scott Silvestri, who currently serves as the Division Chief of Cardiothoracic Surgery at the University of Arizona in Tucson, where he's just joined. Prior to that, he was co-director of the Cardiothoracic Institute in Orlando at Advent Health. He had his medical training in Duke and did a couple of years of research there, where he began to develop his interest in heart failure and left ventricular assist devices and ultimately in heart transplantation. He moved to Jefferson and then spent a number of quite significant years in WashU before joining Advent Health maybe 8 years ago, where I got to know him as a good friend and colleague. I mentioned that he's a larger-than-life character, for sure, totally and utterly passionate about what he does and dedicated to his patients, almost beaten by his dedication to collecting Ferraris. I'm sure he has a lot to say about life in general, so without further ado, we'll go over and join the conversation with Scott Silvestri. Now, don't forget to like and subscribe to the channel. It does help. And I'd really love to hear your comments as well about the interviews and maybe even who you would like to see me interview in due course. I'm John Monson, and this is Surgeons' Lives. Okay, well, thanks for Scott for joining what we call Surgeons' Lives, which also has a subtitle of Stuff That Matters. So yes, of course, we spend some time talking about the wonderful academic and clinical career, but also some other aspects of life that I think are equally important. So what I normally ask is, and I'll ask you to do this, is to start us off with a brief life story, starting with the words, "I was born in."
All right. I was born in the Bronx, New York, and most of my interactions have been colored by New York City playground rules for basketball, which means no blood, no foul. My father was a car guy and a mechanical car guy. He started off working with Otis Elevators and ultimately became a sales guy and then a manager and ultimately a dealer. And had a passion for cars. Every time my mother wanted a new car, my father found a way to annoy her with a new car, whether it was a 289 Mustang or when she wanted a station wagon, he got a Lamborghini station wagon shooting brake, one of 20 made in the world, which I would kill for now. I am the product of New York City public schools. I went all the way up to New York State public institutions of learning, Cornell University. And then I graduated to private institutions of the oldest medical school in the United States, not the world. We know that, John, the University of Pennsylvania. And from there, you know, with all of my habits and my New York City etiquette, I went down to North Carolina, where I trained at a place called Duke. And I learned very important words the first 2 years, and that was please and thank you, sir and ma'am. And then I also learned how to say the plural of y'all. Do you know what the plural of y'all is, John?
No.
It's all y'all.
Yeah. Of course.
You can always tell a Southerner if they know the plural of y'all. And so so that's basically my story. And then I met my wife at Duke in the second oldest story in the book. She was an operating room nurse. I, on one day, was accidentally nice. And she thought that would be the tenor of our entire lives together. She was also the daughter of an orthopedic surgeon, so she had some idea that would not be the tenor of our lives together. We were married after training, and we have two boys and a niece that we've raised since 8, who's 23, and we have Sam and Ben that are 17 and 15, and who, for the most part of their early lives with me, have shared a love of cars. Now they sort of diverged and differentiate to their own interests.
And you spent some time and you did, I think, a couple of years research in Duke, yeah, which was, I'm pretty sure, semi-obligatory, if not obligatory.
So I actually, when I was at the University of Pennsylvania, I worked with a doctor called Kevin Shulman, who was a MD, MBA. And I actually ran an HMO when I was in medical school as a medical student. And I hired my friends, some of whom were Wharton MBAs that I met at the Wharton Happy Hours. And so I ran an HMO, John Hancock, and I did med equity research for Shearson Lehman when Shearson Lehman existed. And the reason I bring this up is when I trained at Duke, again, fish out of water, but a hard worker, which is what Dr. Sabison liked, it came time to have the conference with him. When you were a first year resident, he would talk to you about what he thought your career would involve and where you would go. And so of course, everybody was required to be to do 2 years research, and everyone was required to at least try to get NIH funded. So I went in and said, yes, sir, I'd like to go work with Kevin Shulman at George Washington and explore cost effectiveness of therapies, including surgery and cardiac surgery, and do this. And he said, yes, that sounds like a really good idea. You'll go into my lab and you do cardiac physiology. I said, well, if I'm going to do cardiac physiology, maybe I could go work with Sir Magdi Yacoub at the medical research at the MRC. And he said, yes, you'll be going into my lab with Don Glauer. You'll write an NIH grant and you will be studying cardiac physiology. Any other questions, Dr. Silvestri? And I said, no, sir, I'd be ecstatic to go into your lab and study cardiac physiology and learn all about the things that I've learned in the 2 years in the lab.
I had a young resident when I worked in Imperial College come to me and said that they were going to go into cardiac surgery, and they'd arranged an interview with Magdi Yacoub. I said, oh, that's fantastic. Where and when? He said, well, you know, he's arranged to see me at 2 o'clock in his office in Harley Street. I said, okay, that's fantastic. I said, is that 2 o'clock in the afternoon or 2 o'clock in the morning? And he said, what? I said, check, would you? Check. And he came back about an hour later and he said, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. I said, yeah, that's Magdi.
Yeah, well, at least he didn't interview him at 2 o'clock in the morning in Egypt, right?
So,
which is certainly possible.
So your dad was a car guy, worked for Otis. So where did the medicine come from and where did the surgery come from?
Yeah, it's interesting. So my grandfather was a Russian immigrant. And as a Russian immigrant, you know, I grew up, he worked on 7th Avenue, and when he was young, he sewed and he made pieces. And of course, he got paid for each piece, and they learned to work harder and faster so that they could make more. There was no hourly wage. You were a piece worker.
Yeah.
Eventually, he was a smart guy, and he did well for himself in savings, and he had a little haberdashery shop. And so I used to go to his haberdashery shop, and as I can show you pictures of my brother and I as young boys in top coats and Tammy Shanders and wool pants and shoes, all from his store, as it was, you know, walking down the Grand Concourse in the Bronx on a winter Sunday for social reasons. And he used to say to me when I would go to his store, you know, if you're a doctor, you help people. And if you're a surgeon, you work with your hands, and that's an honest living, and it's honest living working with your hands. So it's not a surprise that my brother, my older brother, is a cardiologist, and that I became a cardiac surgeon. My older brother perhaps likes to talk to people a little bit more, and I prefer just to, you know, open them up.
Yeah, I interviewed somebody recently, a good colleague, Neil Mortensen, whose father was a minister, and you know, he one of the reasons he went into medicine was because it was considered a worthy occupation, yeah, as opposed to just going into business in the city and making money. So it's a similar version of that story.
So it's funny. It's not a coincidence that my brother and I both went into cardiovascular medicine. We were young. Our grandfather was, my mother's father was seminal in our upbringing and our values and our system. Of course, he encouraged study. He funded our study to become bar mitzvahs. And when I was about 8 or 9 years old, he said to me, I have the worst headache of my life. And he wanted to go sit down. And my grandmother said, no, go out and play with the boys. And he went out on a Sunday and played with the boys. And of course, then we went back to our place. And later that night, my mother was called to the hospital because he had had a stroke. And so I never forgot that story, that he had a berry aneurysm. He had hypertension, was treated with all sorts of drugs that wasn't really effective. All of those drugs that they had in the 70s And that then he had an intracranial bleed with the Sentinel, the literal Sentinel. I'm sitting at the University of Pennsylvania in the class, medical school, and they're talking about Barry aneurysms. And it dawned on me that that's what my grandfather had, and that's what ultimately took his life, was this Barry aneurysm with a theory of hypertension. And it brought it all home, because he was the one that really wanted me to go off and do these things.
Yeah. And it's interesting you say that, you know, the interview with David Sabison, you know, because he was legendary for, you know, and to his credit, for meeting with the residents, but not just the residents, the medical students as well. He would meet on a regular basis, I believe. I never had the privilege of knowing him, but, you know, it seems to be that was a passion he had.
So when you were a second year resident, also known as a junior resident or a JAR, you were the teaching resident, and for 2 months you were responsible for, you came on in sync with the medical students, and your most important job was shepherding them to the various places and helping him, because he was a big part of their rotation. He gave rounds and such, and they presented to him, and your responsibilities were to help Dr. Sabison with presentations, prepare him for the medical students, which meant he would always go through the roster of 30 students or 25 students and say, how do you pronounce this name, Scott? How do you pronounce this? He put such emphasis on the details and knowing and courteous and invested in them. And then the other part that you had to do with the medical students was you had to make sure that they were prepared, because everyone wanted everybody, you know, we referred to it, and sure they did across the pond as well, as a dog and pony show. Yeah. Everyone knew what they were supposed to do, and the medical students had to look good. If they didn't look good, it was because you didn't prep them right. And I'll never forget one student that was one of my students, who is now a prominent cardiologist on the East Coast, a very prominent cardiologist on the East Coast, had presented to Dr. Sabison and had total vapor lock. Like, couldn't say a word, went completely tharn, as they say in the South, and almost I had to ask him a quick question to sort of snap him out of it and get him going. But having heard the presentation so many times, I just simply said to him, and of course, this patient is from Onslow County, aren't they? And of course, Dr. Sabison was from Onslow County. And so it had special meaning to him. And the student sort of woke up and then went right into the rote presentation that he had prepared, done so many times, forgetting to be nervous. But that was our responsibility. And you're right, Dr. Sabison was a great educator and put a tremendous emphasis. And the other thing that we did that brings up, and one of the reasons why I went to Duke was, you know, everywhere you went, you interviewed for a day. At Duke, you interviewed for basically 3 days. You showed up on Friday, and then you had dinner, and then you had Saturday conference, and then interviews and a tour, and you could stay and see other things as well. And so we didn't realize it at the time, but everyone we interacted with had the opportunity to evaluate us for suitability. But watching the residents give a presentation, an hour in general surgery and then an hour in cardiothoracic, you could see the product that you were going to become. And I have been very fortunate in my life. I just gave the William Pierce lecture at the Hershey Medical Center in mechanical circulatory support this past Monday. And people, they said that was a very good talk. Thank you so much. And you were, you know, tremendous with the residents and the things. And I thought to myself, that's not me per se. That's what Dr. Sabison did for us. And whether it was, you know, some of the really, really greats who came over from England, Sir Roy Kent, I think, and Stephen Large and others came across, and we hosted them.
Yeah.
And we were responsible for shepherding them around, and we learned how to interact, and we also learned what a visiting professor should do. So no matter how tired or bored they were, they would ask questions of the residents, they would make like it was an interesting case, they would probe, and everyone got something out of it. And that's really the tradition, the legacy of Dr. Sabison and the history, the greatest part of the history of American surgical training from Blaylock, from Halstead to Blaylock to Sabison and down. Of course, now we can't yell at anybody.
Well, so we'll come back to that in due course. So when you were graduating as a resident in Duke and moving onwards, can you remember what your ambitions were then?
Yeah, I mean, I always wanted to be a transplant surgeon, and I clearly wanted to do that. And it's very interesting because I never wanted to do anything easy. And that, I think, comes from my grandfather, who never shied away from doing something. Certainly, if you were a piece worker on 7th Avenue and you become a store owner and then you go on to develop that and be responsible for your family, that the implications and the benefits of hard work were there. And it's funny because when I interviewed, you know, very few people from the University of Pennsylvania trained at Duke. It was a cultural difference and it wasn't geographically close. But Dr. Sabison asked me, a question during the interview. And he said, do you have any, you know, words or mantra that you live by that are important to you? And I said, yes, sir. You know, opportunities often disguise this hard work and people don't recognize it. Of course, that was quoting Halstead to someone who loved Halstead. And he took the piece of paper and he brought it back and he wrote a little thing on it and he put it to the side. And then he asked me something else. And I said something that was very consistent with Blaylock. And I didn't even realize it at the time. And anyway, he took the piece of paper and wrote something else. And later, as a resident, I was privileged to be able to sneak into my interview file. And it turns out that on that interview, I got this the double star, which is the two little marks, which meant I was the person in that session that he most wanted to have. And so that, you know, the idea of working hard and becoming something that that I could and be proud of. And at the time, a lot of the allure and a lot of the real drive in cardiac surgery in 2000 was really transplant had been back on for a period of years with tacrolimus. And so the opportunity was there. And it's not a surprise that a lot of the cardiothoracic residents and fellows from Duke have gone on to be significant in transplant. Ash Shah leads the biggest program in the country, if not the world, at Vanderbilt now. And of course, the program at Duke is maybe the second biggest, depending on the day. And so that's kind of the opportunity, in addition to the preparation and the drive, met well in Durham, North Carolina, if one works hard enough.
So you've obviously gone on to become an international figure in, you know, as a colorectal surgeon, I'll describe you incorrectly, obviously, but, you know, in areas of transplantation, mechanical assist, cardiac failure, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, you went from, if correct me if I'm wrong now, you had a brief sojourn or moderately brief sojourn in Jeff before landing for a fairly significant formative period of your career in WashU. So in your, you were a product of the Bronx, as you say, and with all the diplomatic skills of the basketball court on the street.
Yes.
And although you worked in a location with you know, Southern gentility, and for a man with you know, great Southern style about him, but not the easiest of individuals. Is the Scott Silvestri that entered Duke, left Duke, joined WashU, the same person as the person now who's just joined Arizona?
Well, we all wisen with age and experience, and we get scars, which help color our interactions. I remember leaving Duke thinking they didn't break me, right? Maybe it would have been better had they broke me in a lot of ways, because my determination was still there.
Was it a battle for you?
There was clearly times that one might wanted to respond differently, but clearly the expectation was you wouldn't. And so I'll tell you a story. When I was the junior resident, I was downstairs. And of course, you may remember, your listeners and viewers may not know, that we wore short white coats and short white pants. We wore white pants, and we actually had to wear certain shoes. And in the OR, we wore white shoes and the rest. And as the teaching resident, we took call in the emergency room, and it was a Saturday night. And we weren't even allowed to wear scrubs in the emergency room. And so I got covered in a trauma and blood. And there's nothing more macabre than white jacket, white pants covered in blood. And I had to go meet one of the students to prepare them for Dr. Sabison on Sunday morning post-call. And of course, I could not walk through the hospital with bright blood on white surgical uniform. And so I put on scrubs, and my socks were soaked, so I took them off. And I put on my shoes, my white shoes, and walked upstairs. Now, of course, Sunday morning, the last person that you would think at 7:45 in the morning that you're going to run into walking down the hallway, the Hall of Shame, is Dr. Sabison. And that's exactly who I ran into. And so he gave the come hither look, and he pointed at his office, and we went and go sat in the green chair. The green chair was covered in blood by residents for the bites they would get. And he proceeded to lecture me about this was not up to the standard, and you weren't allowed to do this. And did I ever see Tommy D'Amico in these things? And that, and I must be stupid or I don't care. That was the fork that he got you. And of course, he didn't want an answer because you had to say I was stupid, because if you didn't care, you would get fired. But my point is, there was no time nor expectation. If I had tried to say, sir, I was covered in blood, which are here in my bag, and I was meeting the student, I was coming up to be in my to get my spare whites to meet the student on a Sunday morning, nobody cares. And that's, you know, that's the reality. And so sometimes it was a battle. I mean, rational, reasonable people would want to explain and justify themselves. No, of course I know what the cultural expectations are. Of course I adhere to the cultural norms. Of course I want to shine in your eyes, right? As a surrogate, I want you to approve of me in a way that will then bless my career. But so a little bit it was that. And so what we have to do is, you know, so much of what the training was at Duke and other places at that time was by negative, not positive.
Yeah. But it's not necessary. And it wasn't.
And that's my point.
And it wasn't.
It's not necessary.
It wasn't necessary then either. You know, it's you know, it's we could obviously talk about this for days and weeks, but you know, the culture has changed. But the reality was that even in the day of training by fear and humiliation, which was such a common way of doing it, and various organizations had, you know, levels of reputation for that, there were others who did not teach like that, who did not train like that. And it's
Dr. B at Hopkins, Dr. Baumgartner, was legendary. Also one of those to do the first heart-lung transplant ever. Dr. G. Alec Patterson. So Alec Patterson was from Toronto and maybe had an advantage of being Canadian in terms of being nice, was voted one of the best physicians in the country, got the medal for the best physician in the country. Both he and his wife, the chair of plastic surgery at the time, had the medal. Dr. Patterson's scrub nurse during a lung transplant dropped the lungs on the floor. He didn't raise an eyebrow, didn't open his voice. And he was asked later, why would you do that? And he said, do you think the scrub nurse knew that she dropped the lungs? Do you think she felt bad about it? And I didn't think that doing anything in that moment would ever be more helpful than simply picking him up, washing him off, and sewing them in as quickly as possible. And he's right.
Yeah,
he was a phenomenal leader, never raised his voice. We knew what the expectations were. They were telegraphed to us. And you personally felt horrible if you let him down.
So you
without ever saying a harsh word.
You commented earlier, just briefly, that nowadays you couldn't say all of the things that, you know, were said by some of these withering individuals, etc. And you're right, you couldn't, you know, you'd be spending most of your week in human resources, etc. But I think the point I'm making is that the Dr. Pattersons of this world did not need human resources. They had, you know, they'd been, you know, whether that's, I don't know whether that's genetic or not, but I, you know, one of the people I interviewed, Justin Dimmick, you know, commented that when he was a student in Hopkins, he realized that he loved surgery and he wanted to do surgery, but he also realized he didn't want to do it in Hopkins because of the culture there. And he went to Michigan and he says, and it's on the interview, he says, you know, in my entire residency, I was never shouted at once. Now, you know, it's pretty lucky to go through 4 years, 5 years, 6 years of residency of life, never mind residency, with nobody shouting at you. But the point is well made. It's not necessary. So
agreed. And that's the mantra today. And the trick is, for those of us, and they call us dinosaurs now, right? The trick is to figure how the dinosaurs can do other things and how we can motivate using difference. And I think Alec Patterson and other people like him have set a mold and a model and set the bar very high and shown it as possible. And that's why they're revered, but more so that's the obligation to us to be kind and to show and lead by example.
So I guess that gets back to another version of the answer to the question I asked you. You know, is the Scott Silvestri of 2024 the same as Scott Silvestri of 2020? And you know, my guess is some, but not really.
So it's interesting. I have this debate with my wife, who is one of the nicest people that a person could ever meet. Truly, she's a fantastic individual. She always sees the best in people and in any situation. I, growing up in New York City, default to threat assessment 101. How can this person hurt me? And how can I hurt them before they hurt me? I mean, literally sometimes at night when you're walking on the street, you're making a threat assessment. I would say to you, I may not always have been nice, but I've always been kind. And I think that there's a difference. And the kindness in me has been a theme for my entire life and will be there. And what I have learned is, as I've gotten older, is I can have that, and I can have that out there, and I can be known for that without it diminishing my stature or my effectiveness in any way possible. That I don't have to pound my hands on the desk to get things done, that people will listen, and doing the right thing, people want to be motivated, and giving them the tools to do it and showing them that you are their colleague and their advocate is often all you need.
So just I'm guessing that's partially also an answer to a question that I sometimes ask people, which is, you know, what advice would they give to their younger self, or indeed a young surgeon coming up, number one, and number two, whether you have any, you know, regrets over your career of a couple of decades. I mean, it's partially answered in what you just said, that, you know, it's not necessary to view life as a battle, as a war. I remember a boss of mine who shall remain nameless saying to me 30 years ago, he'd done a favor for a colleague, and he said, that means that guy will owe me when we need it. And I said to him, need it for what? I mean, and he said, you know, when the day comes. And he was deadly serious. And I said to him, like, what day? What is this day? You know, and will we, how will we know that it's the day?
he said, just hold it.
So go on.
I did. There was a young colleague in Florida who had just joined from the Cleveland Clinic at one of our sister facilities. And I could see that he was wound very tightly and he had concerns. And I said to him, I pulled him aside. I said, look, no matter what happens, just remember, you know, the cases will come. The money will come. Don't fight it. Be true to yourself and your mission. Help the patient. Keep the patient at the center. And the rest of it will clearly take care of itself.
So two quick questions. So the first one is, I'm guessing the job that you do now, heart transplant, mechanical assist, heart failure in 2024, is wildly different to when you started your faculty career.
Yeah, tremendously. The technology has gotten better. The access and awareness has gotten better. You know, and the surgeons have gotten better. When I was giving rounds, I was asked a similar question. I said, you know, this generation of surgeons are far better than I am. And, you know, if they've stood on the shoulders of giants kind of thing, but they're really very good. They make good decisions. They have learned with teams to work very well and critically ill patients. And that's been one of the thesis of my later career, is that teaming is our secret weapon to allow us to go from mediocrity to well above average and excellence, that by supporting teams and showing what's possible, you can clearly do more than you can alone. The whole command and control cult of personality structure that was in great programs in the past has really gone by the wayside. And instead of great surgeons, we have great teams. And that's sort of the secret weapon. And so the surgery itself, the decisions have actually gotten easier. We use ECMO, we use things that are percutaneous, we use ultrasound. We don't have to make big incisions in the middle of the night. We have to make good decisions. And if we default to the group and a collaborative model, we make better decisions.
Yeah, and it's one of the many aspects of medicine that is truly a team sport. You can't do it. Again, going back to one of my old bosses who was a legendary cardiothoracic surgeon in Dublin, became president of the college, and who'd worked. He traced his lineage back to the King's pneumonectomy in Buckingham Palace with Bill Cleland, who was, of course, the giant, etc. And he was one of those individuals who was just a truly gifted technical surgeon. And I remember him bemoaning, and he was an old-fashioned thoracic surgeon before CABG was invented. So valves repairs and bronchiectasis and stuff like that was his joy, which, he was a joy to watch. And I remember him saying to me that he was delighted he was retiring when he was, because he would not have wanted to become a cardiac surgeon at that time, starting, because the operation of a CABG was technically so easy. And it was everyone else that did all the work, in the OR, the pump technicians, whoever it might be, cardiologists. And he felt it was just so, it wasn't really satisfying for him as a technician, as a technically gifted individual. But of course, it comes back again, because now there's operations going on that he would never have dreamed of.
Yeah. Yeah. There's always room for gifted technical surgeons in medicine.
Yeah, he was the last of the prima donnas in his era that I was lucky enough to sort of see at the end of his career. And he was never a shouter. He was very withering in his commentaries about various things. And I remember him saying to me one day, he looked at me and he said, if ever you see me in the hospital, follow me. He said, and if ever I say anything, write it down. You may need it.
Well, it's interesting, because Dr. Pierce and I were chatting, and we had a common colleague. I had met Christian Cabral in 2015 or so at the La PTA. I asked him, how did you have the courage to do the things you did? The cardiac surgeons in the 50s and the 60s went against survival odds that were 20 to 30 to 40%. And we deal with mortality risks of 2%, and that's being high risk. And he said, well, the patients were dead. And if we didn't do something to save them, they would not live. And so that was the mentality that they had. And Dr. Pierce said something very, very similar in that setting. And we asked the question, I'll ask you the question, do you think there'll be giants in the future? Because these surgeons, your surgeon, Dr. Cabral and others, Dr. Sabastin, were clearly larger than life. They were larger than life for the impact on the field, for the impact on the people who were fortunate enough, or I consider myself lucky enough, to have spent time with Dr. Sabastin, to be in his orbit and be aware, and to have been molded by the standards that he set. Will we have that again?
I without hesitation think the answer to that is yes. But in the whatever decade, in the 50s or 60s, the giants were people who were willing to do the operation. For example, as a very young resident, I was able to see the disappearing image of a guy called Marian Ionescu. So Marian Ionescu, you know, invented the Shiley valve, etc. And he was an eccentric genius, to say the least. Every operating list, he was sustained by two things, a packet of Galois cigarettes and a bottle of Maalox, and both were empty at the end of the operating day. And he went to a lab, he made the valves, he went to the OR, he operated on the patient, and they died. And it happened day in, day out, day in, day out, until they didn't die. And his answer to that question was, they're going to die anyway, because there is no treatment for these people. Now, I think the giants, so he was a giant of that time because he did something technically that nobody was going to do. But I think the giants in the future will still be true students of whatever disease it is. And I think they will think the unthinkable, not necessarily do the undoable. But they'll still
a good
make
point.
A difference, you know?
Well, I think a lot of the people that went into cardiac surgery in the 60s and 70s are now going into tech. And I think that when you can do a cardiac operation in almost every hospital in the country, or 80% of the hospitals, with a 1% mortality, then it's no longer attracts the same type of people. And it's interesting, because what's directly at odds with teams is the persistence of the individual and their belief that they will prevail. And one of the challenges, one of the things that you can say, Dr. Ionescu or Dr. Gibbons, to do the first operations that were successful on a mechanical heart-lung machine, not cross-circulation, were that they believed that they would be successful. They harnessed the chaos in their environment and in the unknown to perform things that, as you said, were undoable. Now we are focusing on building environments that make everybody doable, from this everyone's work doable, in a different and more democratic way. And that's what the change is. Whereas, where are the great swaths of the unknown? I mean, Elon Musk, tech, developing apps, developing things. So I don't know that we're getting the same people going into surgery specifically that we got. Maybe they're all going into interventional cardiology, and what's miniaturized and technologically based is what's possible with a catheter.
Sure. But there'll be game changers for sure. So let's just move on and momentarily pause and say, so you're now in Arizona, 2 weeks,
yes.
I think you said.
Yes.
So, and you're obviously standing in your new abode. For the viewers to know that, sufficiently new that you don't even have cable internet.
It just clicked on.
Okay. What's the excitement for you in Tucson?
So it's interesting. I returned to my roots. I have a background of inquiry and asking questions. Some colleagues and I did the first new textbook in thoracic transplant and mechanical circulatory support, published last year with our colleagues, because there wasn't a resource for our young people. And with some of the advances in transplant being on the donor heart preservation side of things, this is a phenomenal place to do some research in simulation, in training, and in looking at the basic biology behind the hearts and how these techniques are going to help us understand what the next breakthrough is so that we can perform more transplants. Tucson has a legacy from Dr. Copeland, Jack Copeland, of the total artificial heart and heart transplantation, and building a school of, like Dr. Sabison, of surgeons, and a school of trainees in science and NIH funding. And there are several corporations here that are a result. Marv Slapian is a phenomenal cardiologist, cardiovascular biologist, who's done a lot of breakthroughs and continues to push the edges. Coming here to collaborate with him and to help revamp the heart transplant program and bring this service to this area. I will tell you, it's the exact opposite of anywhere I grew up or I've lived before, but it is beautiful. I mean, it is a desert outside here. There are tremendous cactus in the valley, and the air and the light are very special.
And that's a good segue for us to mention that it has a big advantage of being a dry state.
Yes.
Because you have, I mean, you have a house, but I'm guessing that you also have some form of storage facility for some toys, or will do in due course.
Yes. Yes.
So
I
tell
think we
us.
will have to get a dedicated storage facility for a variety of reasons. But yes, the dry air and the mountain air and the roads are, I'm looking forward to exploring them in some of our toys.
So I think I know, of course, that you are an enthusiastic, not to say passionate, lover of Ferraris, as
Yes.
the most obvious of your mechanical passions. When did that start, and what did it start with?
Well, so it started at my father's knee side with a variety of cars and muscle cars, but the gold standard was always a Ferrari, which in the 70s was sort of rare. He had an old 335 GTS and had many, many cars. There's a picture I sent you of a car that was one of his favorites. I don't know if we can show it or not, but growing up next to my father and having that opportunity to spend time with him instilled in the blood a love of cars and Italian cars specifically. It was very, very interesting to see the reaction and to go to car shows with him and see how much he loved it and just put a smile on his face. When I was finally in a position to have some toys, I was discouraged from having any toys in Durham, North Carolina while I was a resident because that was not in the mold of a typical Duke resident. And so I went relatively under the radar and low key with a 1986 Porsche 928 S4 in Indischrot red. So there was probably the first sign of popping one's head above the radar, and then ultimately graduated to some 911s, and because they were intrinsically more reliable than Italian cars,
Everyday
and then went
supercar.
back to everyday cars. Yeah, they absolutely were. And then, as I've been fortunate, you know, there is the trepidation whenever one likes old cars that these can hurt you more than they will help you, more than the pleasure they give you. But the whole idea is you like something because, and you love something despite.
Yes.
And so it is the pain that these cars put you through that extracts a love from you
So
that you didn't know you have.
what was your first Ferrari?
I had a 430 spider, a 430 six speed from 2005. And
What?
interestingly, when I went, I bought it from my regular guy in Philadelphia when I was at Jefferson. And the interesting thing is, it was manual, and the F1 transmission was the new idea. And so this car sat literally in the showroom for 6 months. It was the car from someone who had it down by the shore in Jersey. He didn't drive it at all, had very low miles. And I and my friends, I sent my friends to my sales guy at Porsche of the main line. And I said, "Hey, how much for that 430?" And he said, "This much." And I said, "Would you do this?" He goes, "Nah, I don't know if we can do that." I go, "For me?" And he says, "Let me check." I'm like, "Look, it's been sitting there for 6 months. Nobody wants this car. I'll take it off your hands." And he said, "My manager said for you, we'll do that because you send us all your friends." And I think I actually bought it for at or under what they were in the car for all in, and had that for a number of years. And I'm so glad I had it because the manual shotgun click gated transmission was really
And
the start of something incredible.
now it's more valuable than the paddle shift cars, much more so, because they're rare.
Yes.
I mean, now the paddle shift cars are much less valuable than the manuals. And it's of course the F430 is widely stated as being the first truly usable Ferrari. So 20 years on, or something like 20 years on, what's awaiting, what's needs to be stored, what's in the garage?
Well, I have the ultimate evolution of the 430 in the 16M, which is the spider version made with a race after the Scuderia Ferrari. And there are only 499 allegedly 16Ms celebrating the 16th year of championship for Ferrari. Unfortunately, they sort of Kurt Gowdy themselves. They haven't had a championship since then, and they remain at 16. But it's a spectacular Azzurro California, and I'm told it is the only one in the world in that color. And that is an incredible, incredible car. I have the usable everyday Lusso 12-cylinder, of course, a 12, because Ferraris are 12. And it has back seats, so I can take the kids to school if I need to. And it has all the room that I can go get groceries. And as they say, you take the long way to get groceries, and you're always offered to go out and get some milk, even with Uber and deliveries with Instacart. And then I have the ultimate iteration of the front 12, the legendary Daytona. The ultimate evolution is the 812 GTS. Yeah. We were fortunate to do a tailor-made version of that with spectacular Bordeaux seats that are antiqued and ultra suede everywhere in the car to make it like an old car, no carbon fiber anywhere. And it's just an incredible privilege to be given that car by Ferrari and be able to pick it out and be a steward of that car. What's beautiful about all of these cars is that they will continue on after we're gone. Sure. And that we will be part of the story. So maybe 50 or 70 years from now, someone will say, if I'm lucky, this car was originally bought by a notable heart surgeon who did the custom program and then drove it and spec'd it out in spectacular fashion. When it appears on Sotheby's in 50 years on an auction, and then it went to so-and-so and so-and-so, and as Dr. Sabo would say, and so on and so on.
Exactly. All right, Scott. So I'm going to finish by asking you a series of random short questions. And there's no real, as I always say to people, there's no real right or wrong answer, although I tend to know what the right answer is. But some of them, not necessarily. So what is your favorite movie?
My favorite movie is Moulin Rouge.
Moulin Rouge?
Baz Luhrmann, Nicole Kidman, Ewan McGregor. It's La Boheme with modern music.
Your favorite vacation spot?
Paris.
If you were not a surgeon, what would you be?
Well, I wanted to be an astronaut and a fighter pilot, but I was born colorblind and tone deaf. And so I was actually applying to Annapolis when the old crusty naval medical doctor told me I was colorblind and I wouldn't qualify. So, but if I couldn't, when I was finishing training, I had the opportunity to, because of my work at Shearson, to work for MedTech at Goldman. I did some freelance with some of the people at that time. And so if I couldn't be a surgeon, I would have been a hedge fund manager in venture capital.
Ah, okay. If you had a dinner party in a few weeks' time and you found yourself with two spare seats, two additional guests, and you could invite any two people from any time in history, dead or alive, who would they be?
Oh, that's tough. This is the classic two people. I think most Americans would pick Abraham Lincoln, at least as one of them. Of course, the other all-time great would be Jesus Christ, right? And as a New York Jew, I would love to have dinner with Jesus because I'd love to know the truth.
So here's an even more difficult question for you. You're not allowed to choose anything that is already in the garage. You need two cars for your garage, one for workaday and one for the weekend, and there's no budgetary restriction.
Well, if there's no budgetary restriction, then there's no such thing as work weekend or not. The first car I would get would be an F40 because it is the quintessential car. It is the quintessential Ferrari, and it is the one that is incredible. There's a local dentist who's a friend of mine who has one, and it is just a thing of beauty. and to see the, now he can't see it, but to see the fire in the exhaust as he accelerates. He had the seats redone so his son could have a built-in car seat that he can switch out. And it's just really such an amazing car. And again, so if money is no object, and I'm assuming that work means practicality, so I'll go with a favorite all-wheel drive car that would be incredible. And that's a Porsche 959 Comfort with a K, because the all-wheel drive would let me drive it in the rain or snow or winter. And it does have some vestigial back seats that someone could, if they were either a supermodel who folded up nicely or a small child, could fit in the back.
The last thing I want to know is if you could only have one song with you for the rest of your life, what would it be?
Two Valentine's Day ago, my wife on one of these services had a song commissioned for us telling our story. And it would be that song. Yeah, it was an incredible, incredible gift. And if people are looking for a meaningful present for people who have everything, I tell my wife, it's, I know I'm very hard to buy presents for, because honestly, if I want it, I probably can acquire it within reason. And if I don't want it, then buying it for me is not going to make it any better. But so in the motion and in the act, in this song, telling our story in a beautiful way that I have on my phone and I can listen to it when I'm at the gym or driving, and remind me of the magic that we have in our lives and how lucky we are, was a tremendous gift.
Well, that's a good way to finish, Scott. Thank you. I want to thank you again for taking some
Thank
time
you.
in the midst of your house moving, etc. I want to wish you all the very best in your new sojourn in the desert. I mean that genuinely. And I hope to see you before too long.
So the story of this picture that I showed you, and in many, many ways, many of us maintain our parents' passions to keep them alive for eternity. I went to visit my father at the later end of his career, and he was running his car dealerships. And this picture was on the wall among two others. And I said to him, "You have grandchildren, you have children, you have all of these things. Why do you have this picture of me as a boy on your wall in a place of honor? Just doesn't make any sense. You can see me wearing a little sailor suit type of item from my grandfather's haberdashery. Can you tell if I told you that's a blue metal flake car? It's a picture of a picture. It's the only picture I have of it. I wish I could have gotten the picture when my father passed away.
I had to
Can you tell
guess.
what kind of car that is?" Yes.
I had to guess. I would say it was a Cobra.
It's a 427 Cobra comp with the livery. You can tell by the vents. It was the 11th from the last Shelby Cobra off the line, and Carroll took the last 10 cars. It was the last publicly available car. And
There you
so
go.
it was the thing that my father treasured and loved that car. My mother, by the way, had a 289 Cobra. She is not a car person. And so that picture is emblematic of why I love cars, because it is the thing it keeps my father alive. And this is what I learned, and I'll leave your listeners with this thought. With our children, they walk in our lives for a while and explore our interests. At some point, they have their own interests, and we have to walk in their lives if we want to see who they really are. But for me, that picture in front of my father's favorite car ever is a way of keeping him alive and remembering his passion for something that I also love for
Absolutely.
eternity.
Good words. Thanks so much, Scott.
Thank you, John. Take care.